Ladies and gentlemen, the sound is working. Ladies and gentlemen, very good evening to you. Look, it's an absolute pleasure to be able to introduce to you our guest performer for this evening. Look, I think it's fair to say that Alex de Grassi has been a unique voice in the world of acoustic guitar for the best part of the past 40 years. He has influenced a generation of younger players, and indeed some of those who are not quite so young. Born in Yokosuka in Japan, he was raised predominantly in the San Francisco Bay Area. Alex, from a very early age, was exposed to a wide variety of musical influences. His grandfather led a string quartet and was assistant concertmaster with the San Francisco Symphony. His father trained in classical piano, and his mother was a great lover of jazz. He's been quoted as saying the two recordings that he heard most as a child was Mozart's Piano Concerto No. 21 and the Louis Armstrong Ella Fitzgerald version of Porgy and Bess. His first instrument was trumpet. Alex isn't going to be playing the trumpet this evening, but at the age of 13, he switched to guitar. He's been largely self-taught, but also studied jazz guitar at the University of California, the Berkeley campus, and he also played campus coffeehouses to earn a living. And if I'm led to believe Wikipedia, he also busked on the streets of London as a street musician. I think it's fair to say that the rest is history. He has since embarked on a recording and a concert career spanning, the last four decades. He has recorded no fewer than 18 albums, a myriad of collaborations with other musicians, and he's also been nominated for Grammys on two separate occasions. In the late 70s, early 80s, Alex, together with his cousin William Ackerman, and another instrumental pianist called George Winston, they were instrumental in developing a music label called Windham Hill Recordings. Pardon me. And together, I think they sort of helped evolve the genre, which at that stage was known as New Age music. I'm getting there. I bought my first Windham Hill recording in the mid-1980s. And this is the first time that I came across Alex's music. I was struck then, and I indeed continue to be struck by his technical mastery, his evocative compositions, and his soothing melodies. His music so often has been food for my soul. Alex has just completed a series of concerts and workshops in Germany. Previously, he has performed at such famed venues as Carnegie Hall, the Kennedy Center, and the Montreux Jazz Festival. Clearly, Alex now completes that portfolio with an intimate performance here at the Hurlingham Club. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my very great pleasure to be able to welcome him to the club this evening. May I introduce Mr. Alex de Grassi.
Thank you, Matthew. You made me sound important. Well, it's a pleasure to be here tonight. I'll be playing a variety of guitar music for you. I've written a lot and arranged a lot of music, everything from my own compositions to arrangements of folk songs, jazz standards, even Gershwin, Jimi Hendrix, a little bit of everything. So I hope you'll enjoy the variety tonight. I'm going to start off with a little improvisation and one of my own compositions. This is called, which is called Blue Trout. Don't ask me. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm going to play you a more recent composition. This one's inspired by the late James Brown. So it's kind of a funk rhythm here. It's called Mr. B Takes a Walk in the Rain. Thank you very much. So I'm going to play you, I'm going to start off. I'm going to play tonight some arrangements of what I think of as American folk tunes. Of course, a lot of those melodies and sometimes the lyrics as well might have come originally from over here somewhere in the British Isles. This first one's a spiritual that, at least in the U.S., was probably recorded or that is written down or noted in around the time of the American Civil War. And of course, it was a difficult time. And this came out of the black community primarily, so it was kind of a pretty somber spiritual that has a rather serious lyric, something that would probably be sung at difficult times. So this was called Lay This Body Down, and the original lyrics are very simple. It simply says, "Oh graveyard, oh graveyard, I'm walking through this graveyard, lay this body down." Well, for those of you who are not guitar players, I don't know if there are any guitar players here, but one of the things that I do is I use what's often called altered tunings. So if you hear me tuning a little bit between pieces, it may mean I'm changing tuning. This is when the bottom two strings are tuned down quite low, so I get down into that low note the C note on a cello, for those of you who might play a cello or some bowed instruments. One of those instruments, we say that you use a bow and you know how to read music, so not a guitar player. Anyway, this is I'm going to start with this is a song you might have heard. It's a folk song, probably in the States, sung around the beginning of the 1800s in Appalachia, where people were pretty isolated, and women, were often, this is a woman's lament, women were often sort of forced to do without a lot of things, so I suppose the men were too, but one of the things that was particularly hard was not having to do without a lot of the amenities of life. So this song says, "Once I was single, dressed so fine, now I'm married, go ragged all the time. Oh, I wish I were a single girl again." And you may recognize some other little melodies along the way here, but this is called Single Girl. Here we go, take two. Okay, now I'll play you a water song here, since we are right on the Thames, famous for water music. This is a title piece from a recording I did some years ago, where all the music, all the themes all the music was based on the theme of water. So this is the very slowest piece, and this is the title piece from the collection. It's called The Water Garden. Thank you. Okay.
Well,
I'm going to play yesterday. Let's see. Today is Tuesday. Yeah. Sunday. I was in the southern. I was near Stuttgart playing a concert and finishing up teaching a weekend workshop masterclass. And I took a long walk in the woods with one of the people in the workshop, a place called Schönbuch, and I guess it means fine beech trees. I know beech trees are dear to people in England. Did I mention my wife is English? Yeah. She's still teaching me English. That's you know, I speak Spanish pretty well, and I speak a little German and Italian, and can read French, but she's still working on me on the English, so. Anyway, I think I'll play this another piece from this Water Garden collection and this one's called Lost in the Woods. Thank you. Thank you. Well, Matthew mentioned that I was a busker in the underground once upon a time. It was a long time ago, 1973. We were just kids having fun. It's interesting because I met my wife in San Francisco many years later. And when we got married, we came over to England for a while and visited friends and relatives. And I said, hey, let's go down to Oxford Circus. And I said, you know, we used to play there in Marble Arch and Leicester Square, all those places. And so I said, it'd be good to see it again. I hadn't been to England in a long time. And so we went, and we're walking around, and, you know, of course, Oxford Circus is just crammed with people from all over the world. And I'm going, this just doesn't look that familiar. And then, we walked down into the underground, and I went, oh yeah, this looks familiar. I had spent so much time down in the tube that I really, you know, I just didn't get up out of it that much. Of course, we were college dropouts and street musicians who didn't really think about. All we wanted to do was play our guitars. Well, this next piece is by request from Matthew Taverner, who asked if I would play a cowboy song. Well, he didn't actually put it that way. He requested the specific song, but it is a cowboy song. And one of the interesting things about cowboy songs, I did a little research when I was preparing this collection of music, folk songs and from the North America. And what I discovered was there's a lot of cowboy songs. My wife at the time was doing some writing for the library, and she brought home books, piles of books of song books. And I, you know, was going through them, and she brought home a whole stack of cowboy books and cowboy songs. I went through them and I was amazed how many there were. And, you know, some I'd heard of. And I started to recognize a pattern after a while, which was there were a lot of songs, but not that many melodies. They just kept writing new lyrics and saying, hey, let's use that other guy's, you know, that other melody. So there was a lot of melody sharing going on out in the range. This was long before Napster or any of that. But it was... So consequently, this song, you might, if you do recognize it, you might recognize it as the more popular version, which is called Say Adios to the Rio Grande, which of course is the river between Texas and Mexico. But this, I chose to, even though I'm just doing an instrumental version here, it matters to me, the state of mind. That I chose the version which is called Bury Me Not on the Lone Prairie, which, now that's a real cowboy song. I mean, it's about being alone. And I tried to kind of get into the state of mind of what it must have been like to be a cowboy out in the middle of this big North American continent, where they were herding these cattle like thousands of miles sometimes, and they probably didn't really know where they were going or weren't quite sure, and they probably got lost a lot and were hoping the cattle would lead them to where they wanted to go. So with that idea in mind, in my arrangement, this cowboy gets so lost he ends up in Jamaica. So. Now this is called Bury Me Not on the Lone Prairie.
You'll see why. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, I think I'll finish this first set, as it were, this first half, and let you get on with dessert. I'm going to play you, let's see what I'm going to do. I'm going to play you a Gershwin tune, but I might kind of start with something else. I'm just trying to figure out what that would be. I'll play you a little. Well, just play you the Gershwin tune. I'll play you the Gershwin tune, and then we'll discuss it after dessert. So, this is from Porgy and Bess, and as Matthew mentioned, when I was a kid, I heard that recording with Louis Armstrong and Earl Fitzgerald a lot. My mother loved it, and she even took me to see the Preservation Hall jazz band from New Orleans when I was a little kid, and we lived in California, so. It was kind of a big deal. But this, I found the recording. My mother passed away many years ago, but I found my sister found the recording while cleaning out her garage in Eugene, Oregon. And she sent me the LP, and I put it on, and it just sounded so great. I decided that I would try to arrange some of that music for guitar. So this is one of the ones I did arrange, and this is from Porgy and Bess. It's called It Ain't Necessarily So. Thank you. That was a very nice creme caramel, I thought. I'm going to start off with a piece that you probably all recognize. This is an old blues song called St. James Infirmary. Thank you. you. Much. That's called Shortening Bread. It's a children's game rhyme. So I'm going to play you. When I was a kid, I played a little bit of electric guitar. And I still do occasionally. When I'm at home and there's a party or some kind of fun event, they let me play electric guitar. But I always gravitated towards playing acoustic guitar and eventually a little bit of classical guitar and just a lot of different ways of playing the guitar. But I got asked to contribute an arrangement to a collection of guitar music by the New York Guitar Festival some years ago. And they asked us if we would all perhaps do something that was a tribute to another a guitar player or a composer. So I decided that I would kind of get my electric guitar player fix, but still play acoustic guitar by doing an arrangement of a Jimi Hendrix tune. So I'm going to play you a piece called Angel by Jimi Hendrix. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, I had at the intermission there, Matthew handed me a note from the audience, and which means I need my reading glasses, or I'm lost. It said, so someone wanted me to ask, I guess, how many people here play guitar? Oh, that's great. So we have actually quite a number.
Probably like
a dozen people and probably another dozen that are too embarrassed to raise their hand. Yeah. Okay, that's good. Well, you know,
there's playing and there's what you do.
Yeah. Well, we players, we need an audience. So, we're fine with all of you who do not play guitar. That's just fine. So, and then the other question was, can I play the busking piece that earned me the most money? I think this was from Mr. Paul Lyons, is it? Yeah. Okay. So, well, you know, I was actually a singer more than an instrumental player back then. I did play a few instrumental pieces. I'll tell you what, let me continue on here, and I'm kind of trying to absorb that and see if I can come up with something. So, it was probably a Bob Dylan song. Yeah, it was either a Bob Dylan song or a Simon and Garfunkel song, because I used to play a lot of those. I might sing you a song. I rarely do this, but I'm not a great singer, but I'm not the most terrible singer. I do have I do have a question, and maybe Matthew or maybe one of you guitar players can help me out. I just realized that because I have a limited vocal range, I often play with a capo. Huh? It's in the house. Okay, not in this house. Is there a capo in the house? None of you secretly. Anyway, we'll pick that up, I think. Well, gosh, you know, I don't really do that so much. I've played a little bit, but I don't know if I could really pull off a solo piece for you. Could you? I asked for a capo once, and it was in kind of a nightclub. It was a dinner club, and the chef came out with one of those big platters with a cover. I forget what you call those, but yeah. And he opened it up, and he said, "You're capon, sir." And then he opened it, and there was in fact a capo in there. So. So I'm going to play you a melody you may know. This is an old Irish melody by the harpist composer named O'Carolan. So any of you fans of Irish music, might recognize this. This is called Shabig Shamor.
Somebody. I guess I can get rid of the glasses. Yes. Oops, I mean. You're all forgiving here. Thank you. never let the guitar have a drink at the intermission. So. Here we go. Play you another one of my own compositions. This is another one on the theme of water from the Water Garden collection. And I live in Northern California. I grew up in the San Francisco area and lived in San Francisco for many years. And my wife and I moved up to the country several years ago. But we moved about 2 hours north and into an area that we had some relatives and we had a few friends up there. But it was kind of a big life experiment to see how life would be living far enough from the city that we would really be kind of country people. So we moved up and got a place in the country with a little bit of land. We were there for a short time. We bought an old big one of those monstrous Ford pickup trucks, and we got a dog. And so we were we'd only been married a couple of years, so we were riding down the road and my wife Allison was driving the pickup truck for the first time. The lab was stretched out on the big bench seat between us, and I'm sitting on the far side with a t-shirt and a baseball cap. And she looks over at me and said, "You know, I've lived in this country for quite a while now, she said, but I'm driving my Ford 250 pickup truck down a country road with my dog and my husband and wearing a t-shirt and a baseball cap. I think I've finally arrived in America. So. Anyway, when we first moved there, it was in the fall, and our neighbors gave us a kind of welcoming gift around towards Christmas time of a rain gauge. And being kind of a city guy, I didn't quite understand what that was all about at first. But after the holidays were over, I went out and I decided it was time to go back to work. I pounded a stake in the ground, put the rain gauge on it, and went off to my little studio to work. And I was sketching out some ideas for some new music, and it was probably 2 or 3 weeks into this process when I was coming up with these different themes and putting all this music together, I realized it had been raining every day. I mean, since the day I put that rain gauge up, later that day it started raining, and it rained and it rained. It rained 75 inches in 3 months, from January, February, March. And I was there writing music, and after about 3 weeks, I said, I think I have a theme here. It's called water. So this is one of the pieces, and this is sort of, I mean, it can be whatever you want it to be, but in my imagination, this was kind of felt like clouds lifting up, or maybe to put it in a more realistic context, when you're flying in a plane and everything is just going along smoothly for hours, and then suddenly you hit that North Atlantic storm, and you know, everybody's sort of, it becomes a white knuckle flight. So this is a very kind of calm tune that's interrupted with moments of terror. So. This is called Cumulus Rising. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I had another request from Matthew, so I'm going to see if I can do this one as well. This is a piece I wrote many years ago. It was the title of the very first recording I made back in 1978. That's how long I've been doing this. And the title of that recording was Turning, Turning Back. And I wrote it when I was still in my 20s and ostensibly going to Philadelphia to pursue a romantic situation that didn't really pan out. So I ended up in Chicago. I never made it to Philadelphia, but it's okay. It all worked out in the end. But I got this piece out of it. It's called Turning, Turning Back. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, you've been a lovely audience. I'd like to take you home with me. No, we'd like to take you home with us, I think is the song. Those guys. So I think I'll finish up with, you know, the influence of the blues has just permeated so much music in the last 100 years. So, all kinds of popular music, rock and roll, and even composers like Gershwin and many more. So I'm going to play you a couple of blues, but they're very, very different kind. First one is an arrangement of a Charles Mingus tune called Goodbye Pork Pie Hat, which is a piece he wrote for his friend, the saxophone player Lester Young, when he passed. And the second one is actually an old country blues. It's a train song, really. Written by somebody whose name you've probably never heard, Sam McGee. He sounds like he would have played third base for the Cleveland Indians back in the 50s, but he apparently lived out somewhere in Oklahoma near the train and wrote this train song, which became kind of an old favorite of guitar players. So thank you so much for coming this evening. I want to thank Matthew Taverner for bringing me here, and to Francesca Lowry for dealing with endless little details to make this all come together. So thank you. I'll be in Little Rock, Arkansas next if you happen to be passing through. So. I don't get there that much myself. There we go. Okay.
There's not a great deal I can say after that. Ladies and gentlemen, please, once again, a big round of applause to Mr. Alex de Grassi.
I'm going to play you one more. This is, I'm just reminded now that Matthew, you mentioned at the earlier in the evening that this might be a song that you would, and all you rugby players might enjoy. So here's another up-tempo spiritual for you. This is called Swing Low, Sweet Chariot.
Thank you.